Yeah, I mean this is definitely a keeper. Cunning Spark Mage Gideon and five land or four land because I've got the caller. He mulled to six again, and he's gonna lead with Preordain here. Yep. Top. All right, I think those may be lands. Do I want to play? Let's see. If I play Basilisk Caller turn one, I can go Squadron Hawk turn two, and then Spark Mage turn three, and then I'll have to play Evolving Wilds in turn four. I think I'd rather just play Evolving Wilds turn one, so I'm not equipping the Caller till then. Basically, it costs me one mana either way, but I don't even know if I need the mana for Caller. This gives me the option of spending the mana on Caller instead of being forced to spend it on turn one. And it's not like he's going to Inquisition my Caller, I don't think. So, if he does, I'm not too worried. I think he's most likely to Inquisition Squadron Hawk actually, since that gets around most of the removal spells, and he's got a reasonable amount of one for ones to kill Spark Mage. Though Jerry boarded up to four condemns. And this list is actually really good against Condemn. I mean, yeah, I've got Hero of Oxid Rage, which gets condemned fairly easily, but Koth and Spark Mage both aren't really that concerned with it. I mean, sure, you can condemn a mountain, but that's not a big deal. All right, so he does not have an easy way to kill Spark Mage, so he's mising that one. It also, taking the Spark Mage also kind of kills the Caller, since the Caller doesn't do a whole lot without Spark Mage. He puts one on the bottom and both on the bottom. All right. Go ahead and crack this for a mountain. Gotta be aware of the mana requirements. This post-board, you need a double colors and all both your colors. Someone did ask about what happens when you side in a bunch of cards that, like Core Firewalkers, that cost double color and changes the mana ratio. But the fact is, this deck's got three Terramorphic Expanse and four Arid Mesa, so if you change the mana ratio, it just changes what you fetch for. So I don't think it's actually that problematic, especially since almost every board plan involves taking out Goblin Guide and Geopede, so you get to take out all the early red drops, which means you can lead with Plains Plans, and it's not a big deal. All right, so he also has a Hawk, or well, rather a whole squadron of them, and a land. Spark Mage would have been sweet. Do I want to trade Hawks here? Yeah, I'll see if you would like to. Since he can't equip and hit me next turn, it does not seem like too bad to do so. All right, let's play Stoneforge. Let's get. Do I want to get the Bonehorde already? I've got three guys in the bin. It's going to end up getting pretty big, and it's pretty good with Basilisk Caller. Now I'll get the sword and then play a land and play a caller. All right. See how well that worked out. Well, I guess next turn I could have put sword in and put it on Hawk if I hadn't traded, so certainly potential mistake there. Playing Boros is tough, I'll give you that. It's not a deck I'm incredibly used to playing, though I've played a fair amount of matches with it now. All right, so now what do I want? I think I just play a Squadron Hawk and play a Marsh Flats and pass the turn. I'm gonna put in Sword and start getting in there with Sworded Guy. He knows I have Gideon, which does kind of suck. He might play Gideon and then force me to play mine. If he Inquisitions, I'm definitely getting Hawk in there, or sorry, Sword in there. Of course, I guess I didn't fetch my last Hawk with Squadron Hawk because I. Well, let's go ahead and try to tighten up a little, shall we? All right, so he's bashing. I'm just gonna take it. No, he's not bashing. All right, let's fetch, Stoneforge. So he's got a bunch of Hawks. So he left his mana untapped. He's got a Hawk in hand. It could be for mana leak. I think I'm going to hold off on playing the Gideon for now. Let's equip that guy, and I'll just send with the Hawk and force him to chump. He could have Divine Offering or something, although I don't think Jerry plays it. I guess he does not have a removal spell that he wants to use. And I don't really want to play a whole bunch more guys. Let's play a Hawk, and this time actually get the last Hawk. All right. And pass the turn. I'm curious why. I guess he's got Day of Judgment is what he's waiting on now. I mean, that certainly could be. If he taps out for Day of Judgment, though, I get to resolve Gideon. What is this? Oh, Into the Royal. Gotcha. That kills my Hawk and bounces the sword. See, nice little one of instant that very much confused me as to why he's leaving all his mana up. And now he gets to take the sword. Very clever, very clever. I mean, he is going to take the sword here. There's no way he doesn't, since the Last Hawk and the Steplinks are not as nearly as much of a threat. I guess I did not anticipate the Into the Royal, Into Inquisition line. It was good, though. I think I'm just going to slam Gideon now, since that makes a lot more sense why he's leaving up all his mana. And he doesn't attack. I mean, he very easily could have Mana Leak, though. Ooh, I like that. Let's play a Stoneforge Mystic and see what happens. Get this is a Bone Horde. Yeah, I guess we could put Bone Horde in a turn now. Let's go ahead and start cracking these fetches. Have three Plains, three Mountains out to power Koth and Inferno Titan. Equip a Squadron Hawk with, well, I could equip it with Basilisk Collar. Then if he plays his own sword and attacks, then he gets to get in. So I'm just going to equip a Stoneforge with Basilisk Collar and pass the turn. And I'll throw in a Bone Horde into turn just for value. Again, if he taps out, I get to Gideon. If he doesn't tap out, well, I mean, he doesn't get to play a whole lot of stuff. He's got one Hawk still in hand, four other cards. I've got a Bone Horde that's going to be a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. A 5-5 initially, but obviously going to get a lot bigger as soon as he does things that get it going. let's see what he's got. I mean, it doesn't really matter. Unlike Jace, it doesn't matter too much who plays the first Gideon, since the plus two thing isn't like a big beating or anything, so I certainly don't mind waiting on my Gideon so I can kill his. Basically, the worst case is he taps, or he has got Mana Leak, which it feels like he's sided in Mana Leaks again and has one in hand. Mana Leaks my Gideon, then plays his own. So I'm going to keep holding on to this Gideon until I find a reason not to. All right, let's move the Collar over. And beat down. Getting with these guys. Leaving Hawk back still because I don't want him just playing a sword out of nowhere. And I mean, it feels like I'm going to get wrathed here. So let's move a Collar over to the Hawk anyway. And now I can also play Gideon around Mana Leak if I draw a land. And it seems very obvious he's got Mana Leak. He's not been playing anything. Sounds like he's going to Wrath here and then leave Mana Leak up. I mean, he's got the one Wrath, but he's got it. Still leaves me in an okay spot here. Alright, so he's just going to play the Hawk finally. Alright, time for me to slam Gideon. As well as some dudes. If I draw land, I guess I play all three. Yeah, I think with Bone Horde in play, I just want to play as many creatures as I can. Gideon Ajura, plus two. Steplinks. Squadron Hawk. Alright, and I'm not even worried about Sword here because he has to attack Gideon. So I think this is looking pretty good here. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if he's got. Well, I guess he doesn't have his own Gideon. He's going to bash Gideon for four here. I'm not trading Hawks. I'll let Gideon just take it since I can just keep plus twoing it. Equip Bone Horde to Squadron Hawk. Equip Basilisk Collar to Steplinks. Play Fetch. Bash. If he wants to kill my Squadron Hawk, go ahead. Let's see what he does. I'm going to crack. I guess I'm cracking the Scalding Tarn almost no matter what here. But. So now he's going to. Looks like get a black removal spell, get a Doomblade or a Go for a Throat on the Squadron Hawk. And then I crack the fetch. He takes four. I gain four. And then I plus two get in. He can't quite kill it with the guys he has in play still. And then I still move over to equipment back to Steplings. Ooh. So I've got no mountains left and one plains left. I guess I've got a lot of lands in play. Certainly something to keep in mind. Alright, so. Ooh, unless he's got a Condemn also. Well, if he's got a Condemn, good beats. Let's plus two Gideon. And, I mean, I can actually threaten to kill him next turn if he doesn't have another removal spell. So he attacks Gideon down to two, and then on my turn I equip Bone Horde and kill him. Though, we'll see if that happens. He's definitely going to have outs here. Whoa, that's a big game. All right, well, let's go for the kill with Gideon here, And if he's got a removal spell, I still have got an Inferno Titan. He's at 16. There's no point in putting color on him because he's dead if he hits him. If he condemns him, I do gain a lot of life. Alright. So he has a removal spell. Well, I've got the Inferno Titan. Let's do one and two. That would be two, yes. Alright. Go big or go home. Inferno Titan plus Bonehorde plus Basilisk Collar. On a scale of one to a big game, that is definitely, well, a big game. We've got Inferno Titan bashing for like the full 20 here. It's got to get plus 10 plus, or plus 11 plus 11, so 17, 20, 25 damage with an Inferno Titan. And even if he's got Jace, I get to play Inferno Titan, kill Jace immediately. I mean, he's used up one Condemn and two Doom Blades, so I mean, he could still have another of the, you know, multiple Condemns in his deck. But he's tanking right now, so hopefully he doesn't have it. All right, on to the third match.